Hello, my name is that weird name over there, Pantelis Antoniou. And if you would know me, if you've ever deal with the BeagleBone Black or the BeagleBone, which is a really low cost open source hardware board by the BeagleBone.org. And I'm here to talk about what it means to actually buy into the whole device tree thing and try to migrate from a platform device port file to a purely device tree architecture. As you see, well, we're going to talk about a war story, which is exactly what it was. It wasn't exactly easy, because the big problem with the device tree is that it assumes that everyone has already everything ready to migrate to device tree. That means all the bindings are there, all the drivers support device tree. And as we found out, that's not what happens in the real world. And that led to many problems, but we managed to make it work. So that's what I learned out of this whole experience. So yeah, it's going to look pretty horrible at first, but eventually you can get it done, and it will help you, and you get something out of your troubles. So at first, this was a bird of feather session, so I would expect you to participate, and if you can share your stories. So how many of you here has done any driver development? Can you raise your hands? Pretty good. How many have done a platform device, board file-based platform development? Okay. How many has done a device tree? Okay, just a single guy. Oh, okay, more. Okay, so I think we have a lot to talk about. So in the beginning, we had the original BeagleBone. It was named just BeagleBone then. It wasn't named BeagleBone White, because there wasn't any BeagleBone Black then. It's a very inexpensive Cortex-A8 board. The latest release based on a normal board file platform was on a 3.2 kernel. But as you can see, it was pretty heavily patched. It had almost 15,000 patches on top of the vanilla version 3.2 kernel. So as you can imagine, that's pretty hard to mainline. It just wasn't going to happen. The thing is, it worked. People sold it, and lots of people used it on OEM products. And there was a really big decision to actually try to support everything that BeagleBone White did on the BeagleBone Black. And that led to most of the problems with the Black. So if you know about how a board file-based platform works, you have a board file, and on that board file, you define everything that has to do with your platform. So you declare all your platform devices, you register them, and then you support them. The problem with the board file of the BeagleBone was that it wasn't just for the BeagleBone, it was for all the AM335X based boards of TI, and it was pretty huge, something like 4,000 lines, obviously not on mainline, and it supported, besides BeagleBone, quite a lot of number of TI boards. So when we started doing the BeagleBone Black support, we took a look at it and said, okay, this is going to be really hard. So we said, oh, that device tree thing is the new way to support ARM boards, so let's do that so that it's easier to get in the mainline. So we sat around to do that. So what was the biggest problem of the original BeagleBone support was that the BeagleBone has a number, it's capable of stackable expansion boards, which are identified by an E-square EEPROM, and you read that and you figure out what kind of board you have, and you configure the drivers accordingly so that they work. So this is a fragment of the board file there. And you could imagine that this was going on for a few hundred lines, even more, just saying, okay, if you have this board, then I have to do this thing. But the thing is, you can stack those boards, so expansion boards could conflict, and then you had to do some really complex logic about what to enable, what to disable, and in the end, it was just very hard to add more boards, more expansion boards. And on top of that, if this board was sold to hobbyists, and all these guys want to do hardware with it, they want to create new capes, and they want to do something new with it. So they had, in order to support it, they would have to hack the board file and do the same thing for their own board, making sure that nothing else was affected and everything else worked, so that they could send us the patch, and then we could support their board out of the box. But using the board file just wasn't going to happen. It was just too complicated. So let's start about what happened, and Linus decided, okay, no more board files, we need to do something different. I don't know if you have read that thread where Linus just exploded and said, okay, you should really get your stuff together and you should do something differently. So at that point in time, the PowerPC device tree support was completed, and a lot of PowerPC refugees were in the ARM kernel community, and they pushed for having device tree as the solution to all the problems that the ARM kernel had. So that's what started the ball rolling, and that meant no more new board files. So the thing is, ARM is really complex, and if you have no board files, how would you go out and support every different board that you would create? And this is what the device tree is supposed to be. It's just a structure that describes hardware. And really, that's all that it is. It's nothing more, nothing less. All the other stuff that's happening now in the community is just more self-inflicted problems by the community. So it's not a problem of the technology, it's just that the way that we set out and implement the technology, and the way that we did things led to many problems, because it was hard to get anything in the main line, since everything had to be perfect, because the hardware doesn't change, so the binding in theory shouldn't change, but that's not the case in the real world. The hardware might not change, but that's exactly the same thing as saying that the kernel driver should be perfect by writing it the first time. You shouldn't make any changes to the kernel driver. But we know that's not what happens, so that's what should happen with the device tree bindings, at least in our experience. So I don't know if you've followed the device tree for dummies session, and you know how device tree works. So you have a source file, DTS, that you use a device tree compiler to compile it into a DTB, a device tree blob. And then you load the kernel along with the device tree blob, and when the kernel boots, it will unflatten the tree and iterate over the device node to create the platform devices. And that's it. That means that in theory, you could have a kernel that would support any kind of ARM board. Well, this is a very distant target for us right now. So it is possible to support similar boards, which is something that we do with the BeagleBoard and the BeagleBone. But it's really hard to do that on any arbitrary ARM board, at least now, because there's still work to be done there. So what's the difference when you use device tree is that you don't use platform data. So what happens is when you have a platform device, the configuration of that device and all the things that you need to set up for it to work was defined in a platform data structure, which was passed to the driver so that it knows how to configure the driver. This now is gone. So on your platform device probe method, when you check your platform data pointer, you see that it's null. So you have to use open firmware to iterate over the device tree node and pick up the properties that configure your driver. And another big change is there's no more board or architecture specific drivers. Well, or they shouldn't be. So anything that you've used that was specific for a specific board or for a specific architecture should be a generic driver, and you should use that as much as possible instead of custom drivers. For example, on OMAP, there was a custom pin control driver, OMAP MUX driver, actually, that allowed various things to be configured, even on runtime, like pin muxes and all that. But this is a duplicate functionality of the pin control driver. So that had to be removed. And the pin muxing had to be configured via device tree now. So many of the old customers of the BigBone White had big problems there because they based their design on using that driver, and that driver just went away. So they were pretty unhappy about that. And the final thing about device tree is that it's just pure data. It doesn't do anything related to callbacks. So you just define data, and then your driver should act upon it. There's no callbacks to your platform, specific platform stuff. If you need to do callbacks, you need to use some kind of device notification mechanism, which is not easy to retrofit on an existing platform data driver. So that's up to now. We just talked about the stuff that's just standard for every ARM board when you go out and switch to device tree. But there's something really special about the BigBone, and those are the capes. So the capes can be really, really simple. It just be a PCB that connects directly to some pins in the SoC package. And you just add a minimal amount of hardware so that you make it do something that the SoC already supports. So you could have, an audio cape, you could have a CNC cape, you can have whatever you think you can do by using the capabilities of the SoC. So the target of this board was hardware hackers. And hardware hackers doesn't mean that they are kernel hackers. There was no way that just a hardware guy can figure out what's going on in the kernel and patch it and configure its cape to work without considerable effort. So what we had to do, we had to enable people to do work without recompiling the kernel, and just by compiling a device tree overlay, which will come up to that, they could support whatever hardware they need to without modifying the standard Angstrom image that we used. So another complication is that BigBone Black has extra hardware on it, which is an onboard eMMC and an HDMI framer. And those use the same pins of the capes that the BigBone White used, and they were available before. So there had to be a mechanism. So when you plug in a cape that used the pins of the HDMI framer, for example, the HDMI framer should be disabled, and then you could use the pin that you want to override that functionality. And the same thing with the eMMC. it mostly worked, but there was needed different hardware revisions so that the HDMI framer could work reliably. Some resistors had to be adjusted in value. Another thing that we really want to do is make that all automatic. So if you design your cape and you program your EEPROM correctly, that identifies the cape as a specific cape, which there is support for it. It should just work. You should just plug it in, and it should work. It should load the drivers that you need, and you should have it working. And we pretty much done that. And you need a cape manager to do that. The cape manager is just a specific BeagleBone driver that handles the reading of the EEPROMs, the reading of the baseboard EEPROM, so that it knows if it's on a black or on a white, and load the HDMI and eMMC driver. And then it probes the I2C bus where the EEPROMs of the capes are, and then figures out which device tree overlay to load, loads it, and then you're done. It's working after that. Due to that, this is probably the most advanced usage of device tree in a shipping product right now. So, now that's the easy part. So now we're going to talk about the hard parts. The hard parts is the driver problem. So I don't know if you know how silicon vendors work. After they ship a product and they release the initial version of a working kernel tree, they pretty much don't care about it. They will only care about what's in that chip and what the drivers do if they use the same hardware IP in a more updated silicon version. That's the only way that it makes sense for the silicon vendor to keep on working on the same SoC, because there's no more money to be made there. You know, all chips are not that, they don't have much profit there. So when we started the BeagleBone, we were under the impression that, you know, device tree support is there. We just need to take the drivers, include it in the kernel, make some minor patches, and, you know, it would work. But that wasn't the case. We found out that a significant amount of drivers had no device tree bindings at all. So we had the case where we had a device tree only board, but half of the drivers didn't work because they didn't have device tree bindings. So if you just care about the board booting and having a serial port and Ethernet, yeah, that's okay, but that's not how you can sell product. You need to have everything, almost every hardware IP in the device supported, and supported right out of the box. And we also found out that some of the drivers didn't have working bindings. So that's different. So the way that driver development happens, it happens on many different kernel trees or subsystem trees. So you start with the mainline tree. That's your base, and then you start pulling patches from whatever other tree you need to do to pick up patches so that it works. But even after that, it doesn't mean that they work together. So you had, for example, a USB, which pretty much was really, really hard to get it working, because right at the moment that we started working on it, the whole there was this idea that you should use something called USB PHY drivers, but right at this moment there wasn't anything available, so they were just in the middle of rewriting everything, so we had to do whatever we had to make it work a little bit. Then we have cases where the device tree bindings that were there didn't make sense all the time. So for example, we have a camera cape. So, and that camera cape needs a specific clock to be brought out to the connector and then being fed to the camera chip. But there, no one thought about this use case when they created the bindings. So you had the case where you had to support something, but no one thought about that something needed something from the clock driver to be configured. So we had to go there and fix that as well. I don't know also about, do you know what GPMC is? General purpose memory controller. That's the interface where you connect memory map interfaces like SATAgrams and NOR flash. The way that the driver is written, it's like you have a GPMC driver and then you have various drivers that you connect only specific parts that the driver knows about. So let's say you have the GPMC driver, then you can only connect NAND flash and you can only connect SATAgram or something like that. But that's not the right way to do it in device tree. The right way to do it is to have a GPMC subsystem and then have that have a driver of that GPMC subsystem, export it to the specific board driver so that it can use it to configure the GPMC interface for whatever it needs. So we didn't manage to fix that, but we know that this is pretty bad. So we need to figure a way to fix it in the kernel. So a lot of the bindings that are there only make sense for a very limited set of evaluation boards that the developers of the bindings had at that point in time. So a lot of these things have to be reworked in more general purpose mechanisms. And the final thing is you had to hunt for all the bits about the drivers that you need support all over the place. So you had the mainline tree, you had TIs, internal kernel trees, you had some bits that we had to pull from the DRM kernel tree, we had to pull some bits from the USB devel tree, so it was just all over the place. And I think that's the problem of the device tree bindings acceptance, because the developers submit their drivers and they end up in the special kernel trees of its subsystem, and then when the subsystem maintainer tries to push it to the mainline kernel, some device tree guy will just say, okay, this binding is not good, this binding is not good, and just binding stay on those trees for a few months, which is pretty bad when you have to ship something. So, and of course there's something called booting mainline. What the vendor usually means when it says I'm booting on mainline means I have a serial port and I can boot over initRD, and technically that's correct, but that's not what the customer expects. When you sell a board to a customer that says I'm running mainline 3.12 or something, they expect all their hardware to work. They don't like saying, okay, I can boot with this kernel, but I don't have audio, I don't have video, I don't have USB, which is now the case, I think. So there's this catch-22, which means the vendors cannot deal with churn, which is constant changing in the kernel without any visible progress being made. And visible progress means I finally get my driver into the mainline tree and I don't have to keep after it. But the amount of time it takes for a driver to be developed and the bindings to be developed and submitted and accepted, it's close to 3 months at least, could be even more. And by that time, the kernel has advanced, so you might have to do more changes. and eventually you will converge in getting it accepted. But that might mean almost a year has passed without any visible change for them, to the management. The management would say, okay, you said that you would mainline the driver, but where is it? And this keeps going on and on. So there's no monetary incentive for a vendor to keep on doing that for a long time. So everyone will have its own vendor tree, evil vendor tree. And when a customer comes to the vendor, he would just say, okay, use my tree. But that tree is too far away from the main line. And afterwards, the customer needs to do a lot of work to get to switch to mainline. And the customers really do want to switch to the mainline, because that's where every new thing lands, and you can use whatever new peripheral is there. But you cannot easily do that on a vendor tree, because you need to do all the backporting work, or you can ask the vendor to do it for you. But if you're not a really big company, the vendor won't care. And since we're talking about hobbyists, I'm pretty sure that TI wouldn't care about doing that work just for the hobbyist market. And the final point there is that even huge companies have limited development resources. So from a financial perspective, it doesn't make sense for the vendor to keep his developers making changes just to get something in the mainline. He mostly cares about having them use on the new parts so he can sell more and make more money, and that's it. But on the other hand, the community doesn't really like old kernel versions. So who here has bought a development board and found out that its kernel was, I don't know, 6 years back? Okay, so did you like it?
Yes.
Yeah, the thing is, at the point in time that you bought the board and the amount of resources that the vendor needs or you need to get everything updated, it's just too much, and most people just stay with that vendor kernel forever. Even though they hate it, they cannot do anything about it because all the driver support is there. So, but since we're talking about just open source guys, a lot of distribution just wouldn't accept your board to be supported if it's not mainline. I think Fedora is one of them. And you know, a big point of the BeagleBone was that you can use whatever distribution you want. So while it was shipping with Angstrom, there is a port for Ubuntu, but we couldn't get Fedora to include that in the regular builds, just because it wasn't the mainline kernel. And if you do anything, if you do your own board and you want it supported by some kind of open source distribution, most of the distribution wouldn't care as long as your board is on mainline. And of course, you understand that it's a good thing for you if you have your board supported on any big name distribution, because it means less work for you, and you can just point your customers, download this Fedora version, and will work on your board. And of course, the community isn't infinite. So if you have to support 15,000 patches and keep them around, obviously, no one is going to do it for you. You have to pay them for it. And finally, it's just no fun. You know, if you do stuff for fun, this is definitely not fun. It's something for people that are getting paid to do it. So, what the main points about device tree and why people are whining about it? I think device tree technically doesn't have any big problems. It can be solved. A big technical problem is that there's no checking of the bindings. So if you make a typo in your device tree, you won't find out only after you try to boot the kernel and it won't boot. But that's pretty minor, really. It's something that it can work on. The problem is that it was sold as something different than what it is. It was sold like something that would immediately solve the ARM kernel problems, which is there's a great many diversity in the ARM community. There are so many different boards, and it's really hard to support it. Device tree does help with that. Doesn't mean that it will immediately solve all your problems. You have to do your you have to do considerable work to do it. So the problem with the device tree is not really technical. The transition was handled pretty poorly. I don't know if is anyone around here used to be a PowerPC developer. Okay, so do you remember the transition from Arch PPC to Arch PowerPC? That was handled pretty well, but that's not something that happened on ARM. You know, instead of having an old Arch tree where stuff would continue to be supported the same way that it was, we tried to move immediately to the new stuff. And yeah, okay, that doesn't really work. It doesn't really work. It's just so hard. And then we have some maintainer hostility, because you do know that the ARM kernel maintainer doesn't use the device tree. So the whole thing about moving to device tree is a few years old, but we still have the main kernel maintainer. They don't move to device tree. They still work on their own platform and board-based stuff. So who's gonna, we need to put our best people on that thing so that they can find the bugs and report them and get them fixed. So if you're not using the stuff that you're telling other people to use, how are you gonna fix it? And finally, it was really easy to do board support with board files, because no one really cared what went in there. You could do whatever you wanted on your own board file. It would just pass a minimal review and you could do everything there. But that's not the case with the device tree. First of all, there's no place where you can stick your driver on, stick your stuff without anyone caring. And secondly, the device tree format is readable. So someone doesn't have to be a kernel developer to figure out that this is not right. So you can see bindings that are not really right without knowing anything about the board. It just doesn't feel right. And oops. What did we get by working with device tree? Well, we lost a few months, obviously, but it actually works. It's not something that is impossible to do. And for our target market, which was hardware hackers, they can do all that stuff that I say here. They can create a cape, and they don't have to recompile the kernel for it. They don't have to modify the kernel. They don't really care about what the driver does. They just can configure it by setting properties in the device tree overlay. The device tree syntax is, it's a little bit weird, but you can read it without really being a software engineer or a kernel hacker. And we kind of did what the whole point of device tree was, to support different boards with the same kernel image. And the image that we ship actually works on both the white and the black, and all the peripherals work on both without making any changes. And that's the last kernel that we used, 8.3.13, and we only have about 750 patches on top of that, which is much less than 15,000. So let's talk about it now. Hello? For the BeagleBone support, most of those patches are driver patches. They're not really, they will end up in the mainline when the subsystem kernels are pulled into the mainline kernel. So we had to pull those patches in so that the peripheral worked, but we don't really keep them around just for our own board. They are TI patches that will eventually end up in there.
3.12 has 60 patches and gets HDMI, ADC, MMC, and SPI up on the BigaBone Black. So the BigaBone Black 3.12 RC with 60 patches gets you most of the way.
How many of those patches revert prior patches?
About 10 or so.
Okay. Yes?
The problem you talk about device 3, are they present also in the PowerPC?
PowerPC is considerably easier because it's not as complicated as ARM. ARM, they do exist, but when device 3 was done for PowerPC, we didn't have this idea of device 3 as an ABI or that device 3 only describes hardware, so we were really.
Yes, we do have that idea of purpose.
Yeah, but we didn't really use it when we created it. It was really more freeform. I didn't see anyone whining so much about device 3 on PowerPC. We just did it. It wasn't this much of a problem. Yes?
So we see more and more device driver for devices that you could potentially find in a device 3 compatible platform, but also on a CPI compatible platform.
Yep.
Are we going to have additions of support for this, or are we planning to have a unified firmware API or whatever it is?
Okay.
Because today is device 3.
There are at least three versions that we know. It's device 3, there's ACPI, and there's also something called FEX, but I'm not sure I'm going to use that. it's a Chinese thing. Were you in the Dave Hart's presentation about the Mino board?
Yeah, I was there. Yeah.
Okay, so you know the answer. So probably it's going to be a unified firmware property access method, and you could either have an open firmware backend and or a ACPI backend. It's general.
The question was just about the cave manager and the device tree stuff. Is that all going upstream? Is there active efforts?
I'm going to repost them next week.
Yeah.
Okay. The thing is, the device tree overlay support will probably be easier to get in than the cave manager. But I know that there are people that actually use that. So it seems to work, but we just need to push it. The syntax might change. I'm not sure what's going to happen there.
Are there any plans to make it more, almost more flexible so that other silicon vendors can actually use the cape manager concept as a whole?
There's absolutely nothing BigaBone specific there.
Okay.
So if you had a platform with the same I2C EEPROM access methods, you could easily do that on whatever ARM platform or PowerPC platform, whatever you want. There's nothing BigaBone specific. Yes?
I wanted to ask if the cape manager is not yet another possibly simplified port file.
Well, device 3 is doing the work of the board files. You cannot do what cape manager does with board files because it's completely dynamic. At the moment that the board boots, you don't even know what's connected there. The firmware U-boot, in our case, doesn't even know what's connected on the cape connectors. So it's the kernel that has to probe it considerably after the board init method has been called. Well, in port generic, so it's a more general way to do the board files. We can talk about that later. Yes?
Have you considered moving the cape manager to the bootloader chain and massaging the BTP?
Yeah, we did, and I think Kuhn is more capable of answering that.
So, a little bit of backstory. On the original Beagle board, we also had expansion boards, and we said we want to support them. We have an EEPROM, we can auto detect them, and the OMA kernel maintainer said, bootloaders are evil. Everything and everything in the kernel. We cannot replace bootloaders, well, basically because they work with Mafia hardware. So And then 2 years later, the Vice Tree, and we said, oh, we have this new board with even more things. And they say, move everything to the bootloader. So we tried moving it to the bootloader, but then you had to match your bootloader with your device tree, with your kernel, and that doesn't
why you
work.
Want
that absolutely
tree
does not
API,
work.
So you don't have to match your kernel.
Well, but that doesn't work. It's just you expect that everything will be perfect right from the start, and that's not going to happen.
Isn't it?
Nope. Well, I can do it. If you can do it, that's okay. Yes?
There's nothing wrong with adding a new version of the bootloader when new packs exist. Because what you can do is the bootloader can probe the EEPROM,
well,
determine what's there, massage the block, or at least have you worked with Bearbox, for example?
No. Well, there's a big difference about your audience. If your audiences are professionals, that they will be trained on working on your system, that's okay. Maybe you can educate them to do that properly. But if your audience is people that buy a development board for $50, it's impossible to have them understand how to do that on U-boot if they don't have considerable Linux and U-boot experience. So you end up with brick boards.
I'm saying, for example, using a Bearbox script that is able to massage the device tree before passing it to the kernel.
Yeah.
Based on what's detected on the EEPROM. That's not something you leave with the customers. That's something usual.
Okay.
The customers make sure they have the bootloader and the kernel is booted.
Yeah, but the thing is, that means that everything that the customer is going to use is provided by you. Our case is that the customer might want to create new boards, new hardware.
Yeah, in this case, you can handle the case where somebody has a breadboard and they're plugging wires in to the header. They can have a device tree overlay for that breadboard.
And they actually can remove that device tree overlay, make some changes, reload it without having to reboot at all.
Cannot figure out how to refresh U-boot on all his boards. So if even Russell King cannot figure out how to refresh a bootloader, 90% of the users won't be able to, and that is the problem we're facing. If you ship with a bootloader and you do it 2 years ago, people will be using that till the board dies. And that's why moving it to the bootloader, if we can get everything working perfectly in one go for all future hardware, then yes, but the reality begs to differ.
Well, I think I don't know if you follow the latest device tree thread in ARM Linux kernel. Well, there's a big mess there, and Nicholas Peter said that you cannot hide complexity. So you will have, if you have a really complex system, eventually you have to do complex stuff to figure it out and make it work. So we have a choice: either we split things up and have some complexity in the firmware. Or instead of having a complicated firmware, have a simple firmware, and then do everything in the kernel. And I would prefer to do it in the kernel, because I can fix the kernel. I'm pretty sure I won't be able to fix a broken firmware easily, or at all.
You played with Bearbox, not you with Bearbox.
Okay, there are people that... Okay, but I'm pretty sure people won't even ship with either U-boot or Bearbox. They might use their own bootloader, which really isn't like Bearbox at all. It's nothing, just boots. That's it. And
the problem with the bootloader basically is that it's a boot time. And we have very, very many people tinkering on the BeagleBones during runtime.
Okay.
That's the base problem. And whenever you put everything into one giant DTB blob that gets parsed once, they have to reboot over and over and over and over again. And basically, just judging from the support questions on booting things we see in HashBeagle and HashPanda, once they get the system running, keep them, or make them keep it running. Never shut down again. That's basically the bottom line.
And just on that, we uncovered pretty a lot of bugs in the way that platform device removal works. Because up to now, really it's impossible to remove a platform device after it's loaded. But we found out that when we removed an overlay and we unregistered the platform device, almost 90% of the drivers don't work correctly. So that's another thing that we need to fix. Okay, you sir? Okay, so the overlays is a mechanism to augment a running kernel's device tree with something else. So let's just forget about the BeagleBone and everything. And you have a kernel that's a device tree, and you connect something that brings out a new UART. And you want this UART to be visible to Linux and applications. So you can load an overlay that just says, insert this UART driver node in the running kernel tree and apply it. And it will be exactly the same as if you had that UART device node as part of the booting DTB. And it will work exactly the same. Yes. We know because some both Altera and Xilinx are thinking about it.
All right, this was my question.
But they're thinking about it. Doesn't mean they're going to do it.
You mean like a Verilog to DT converter?
No. They will do it. I'm pretty sure that's why how they will do it, because they have their tools and they generate.
I'm pretty sure it already exists on Altera's side.
So,
as opposed to be joking.
Is anyone trying to convert from platform device and board files to device tree right now, or thinking about doing it?
I've actually almost gone in the opposite direction where I've been taking device tree stuff and making platform drivers work again. So I haven't got the time to go through what you've just been going through.
Okay. Maybe it's easier at that point. Okay.
Yes? Using BeagleBone Black as a starting point, you've done our work for us. Thank you.